Welcome back. If the polls were right, we'd be talking about President-elect Hillary Clinton. So how did they get so wrong? With few exceptions, the final round of public polling showed Hillary Clinton with a 1 to 7% point lead. Pew Research identified three factors that could have contributed to the error: low income and poorly educated voters are less likely to respond to polling calls because of what is called the non-response bias. There may have also been shy Trumpers who didn't want to make their choice for the Republican known. Pew also says the way it could also be difficult to identify people who will actually vote. So how can pollsters overcome these issues? And joining us for more is Mitch Perry, who writes for FloridaPolitics.com, Frank Orlando, the director of St. Leo University's Polling Institute, and Keith Fitzgerald, a professor of political science at the New College of Florida and the former state representative. I've really been looking forward to this show because for political junkies like this, we rely on those polls day and hourly going into the election, and then we got a completely different result. So we'll have to start with the pollster. And one of the things that people have been telling me is that the polling model that was relied on was basically the 2012, the last presidential election, and then as a result, more Republicans came out this year and fewer Democrats. Is that right?
Well, thanks for having me on. Great to be here. I would say that nationally, the pollsters weren't that far off on their model. So I think let's not attack the pollsters too much right off the bat. So I'll stick up for us. But in some of our state models, which is what matters, the Electoral College, there were mistakes on identifying the proportions of people that were turned out. In particular, white working class voters. We assumed that that turnout wouldn't be as high as it was in 2012, and perhaps in Midwestern states, African-American turnout would be at the levels it was in 2012. That wasn't the case, and because of that, in places like Milwaukee and Wayne County, where Detroit is in Michigan, and in Ohio and around the Cleveland area, without that turnout, right, that spelled disaster for Hillary Clinton.
Was there no mechanism to pick up and utilize what a lot of us were hearing? Mitch, you covered this election. I know a lot of my friends, especially my Republican friends, saying, "Hey, listen, there are a lot of us out there." And I had one friend saying, "I don't know anybody supporting Hillary,"
right.
And I kind of poo-pooed them. But that's, in fact, what happened.
Well, you're right. In fact, I remember we were both at the same rally, the Trump rally you had at the big amphitheater in Tampa about 2 weeks before the election. When I went to all these Trump rallies, I'd always interview, and just saying that the Hillary people, interview all the people, as much as people as possible, you know, people that, why are you supporting your candidate? Talked to somebody at that event who came, said he drove from Pennsylvania to Tampa, and he said he saw, you know, hundreds of Trump signs and not one, or maybe one Hillary sign. And reporters, we're supposed to, like, not take those anecdotal, stories as, like, proof of anything. We've been, told signs out there in the yards, that doesn't really mean anything. But this time around, it probably did mean something, obviously, in retrospect. You kind of indulge these people, okay, yes, that's what you're hearing, that's what you're saying. But then again, you think about it, and again, from Pennsylvania to Florida, there's a lot of red states there anyway, right? So maybe I went up thinking that, okay, that makes sense that he's seeing that. But right, there was always that sense. I remember that. I saw a pollster here in Florida say after the primary that, in fact, there was a surge of people who signed up to be a Republican voter this time around, and that was maybe a little bit of the hidden Trump voter that people really were talking about, you know, that early on. But again, you know, we didn't know that. I didn't know that.
Keith, you're on the inside of the party here in Florida. Was there any indication in the days leading up to the election that something was happening?
Not really. In fact, Democrats felt pretty good about the early voting numbers, the vote by mail and the early vote site of the election numbers were looking really good. And I think that and I was fooled just along with you and everybody else in trusting these aggregators of all the polls. I think the outcome tells you something really important about why the Trump campaign won. It tells you about strategy and tactics. Campaigns matter. What they did in the final days of the campaign is they focused all their resources in mobilizing voters who might not vote in a few states, and they did a really good job at it. They focused their message on working class white people, and they got people who don't always vote, maybe never voted before, to vote. And the Hillary Clinton campaign, unfortunately for them, zigged when they should have zagged, because they chose to close on the message of, with the same policies, they could have framed it in two different ways. They decided to say, we're trying to bring in groups who've been excluded, because they were trying to mobilize African Americans, Hispanics, and women. Unfortunately, the Trump people were focusing their message on white working class people who may have felt alienated from that message.
All right, we are just getting started here. We have much more to get into on this subject, but when we return, we'll take a look at our weather forecast, so stay with us. Welcome back. If you're joining us, we're discussing the issues with polling and why the media relies on them. Our guests tonight include Mitch Perry of FloridaPolitics.com, Frank Orlando of St. Leo University's Polling Institute, and Keith Fitzgerald, professor of political science at New College of Florida. Frank, and I know the answer to this question, but can pollsters take into account the realities of what they are seeing in terms of campaigns on the ground? There were plenty of stories about disaffected voters. How can that figure into the polling models?
Well, it's a question that probably a lot of people in the public are asking, and it brought up a point that Mitch made earlier about the public saying, hey, I'm seeing all these yard signs, I'm seeing all this stuff, you know, how do you take these sorts of things into account? It's difficult to change your model on the fly like that during a campaign season, because then you're really making subjective judgments about what you're seeing and fiddling with your model, and I think that has a likelihood of introducing more error into your model.
You're taught not to put subjective opinions into
right.
to the modeling.
Right.
And as people who have been involved in campaigns, we've always been told, ignore yard signs. Yard signs don't get you votes, and they're not necessarily reflective of what was happening out there. Bottom line is, there were a lot fewer yard signs around this year, but there were more Trump signs than Hillary.
Well, and also, I heard stories about Trump supporters not wanting to put signs up there because, again, just like this hidden Trump vote, where it wasn't very popular to be supporting Donald Trump, depending on where you're at. It certainly wasn't the problem in the Midwest or the South, but in even, you know, urban areas like Tampa Bay area, where you know, actually, big story, right? Trump won 10%, 3% over Barack Obama, over Clinton in Pinellas County, where 4 years ago, he won by 10%. It's an amazing turnaround in a county that's considered moderate to progressive, actually. So, you know, we saw some big changes here. Pasco County, it was 3%. I think Obama lost 4 years ago, and this time Trump won by 21%.
So I can speak to in Pasco County, driving around there up at St. Leo all the time. People are not afraid to have their Trump signs up there.
Right, yeah, but even then, you know, I have Republican friends who feared that Pasco County was turning blue.
Really?
When, in effect, it went the other
it
way.
Went better than ever.
Keith, if you are with a political campaign, if you're a candidate or office holder, what do you do with these polls now to show you where you are?
Well, first of all, as a candidate, or if you're on a campaign, the horse race aspect of the poll is really not the value of it at all. You know, you would like to know where you are, but what good does it do you in allocating resources to know if you're 2 points behind or 2 points ahead? What you do use a poll for is to figure out what messages work the best, which ones do you not want to emphasize, which groups of people do you need to be paying more attention to, and who do you want to pay less attention to? How do you target your media and make your buys sensible? So you're really using polls for very different things. And I don't think any of these problems really would undercut the value of a poll from the standpoint of running a campaign.
But are the polls reflective accurately of those issues?
Well, you know, obviously you always want to, like, the internals of a poll are very important. Now, depending on sample size, and if you're a candidate, that depends on how many resources you're going to be able to invest in polling. If you can invest in a poll that has, you know, 2,000 people, you're going to get good internals on Hispanics, on African Americans. If you don't have the money to be polling those groups, then the internals become a little bit less useful because you just have a smaller sample
size.
So
weren't the polls that were out there showing that middle-income white voters were feeling that the economy and income inequality was foremost on their mind, and shouldn't the candidates have picked that up?
Well, I think one thing that maybe we underestimated on white working class voters, and also just white Republican voters in general, especially Republican women, we underestimated the effect that partisanship had on bringing them home by Election Day. And I think we were looking at all these internals.
One of the things I'd say in defense of the pollsters is that, remember, polls are taking place on a particular day, and they're usually reporting the last 3 days. These things changed a lot in the last 3 days.
Well, there are a couple of issues I want to get into. You hear headlines across the country, this is the end of polling, because it is becoming more difficult for pollsters to get an accurate read because people are harder to reach. Right. They rely less on landlines, more on cell phones.
Well, you know, that was a story actually before the primary season, because you had Brexit, you had David Cameron a couple years ago. There's some international polls where there was a big story thing that polling was a problem. And then in the primaries, it was actually pretty good, except for Michigan, where Bernie Sanders had this incredible, raucous win because everybody thought he wasn't going to win that. So now we're coming back to this, though, this argument about polling, because I think it made a comeback, if you will. A couple other things I want to say about this, though, Alan, about, and Frank said this about nationally, Hillary Clinton's lead right now is close to 1.9%, because California, they're still counting votes. So, you know, basically she's won the popular vote by 2%. If you go by, you know, plus or minus margin of 2 to 3%, it is actually not that, you know, disaccurate, if you will.
Right. Now, it turns out that St. Leo polling has come out with a new poll just today, including on some of the issues involving the election. Incredibly, that 69.3, almost 70% of Florida voters voted for Trump because they wanted change. Many, 58, almost 60% of Florida voters thought that Hillary Clinton was corrupt, and that Comey's letter to the Congress from the FBI, that impacted 40% of Florida voters, and increases to Obamacare costs, 38.9%.
Yeah, a lot of voters are going to, you know, after someone votes, sometimes people look to justify their vote.
Right.
And so, you know, some of those are inflated. But I think when you look at change, people looking for something different, that was definitely a message that Donald Trump had.
Here are a couple of other of your findings in terms of forgiving your family and friends. 23.8% of Florida voters said that they have forgiven their family and friends. 41% have not.
I believe that. I do.
Well, one of the things that's happening is this divisiveness and partisanship is a far greater factor of life than it has been really since the 1860s. Not a good time to compare yourself with. And, you know, and I think that that's something we all need to start thinking about wherever you are in the spectrum.
Here is something else we have to start thinking about. How do we fix this? I mean, Frank, do you have any hope that 4 years down the road, somebody in your industry is going to figure out something so this does not happen again?
Look, and, you know, I hate to defend polling, but we have been pretty accurate for a while. We were wrong on Brexit. We were wrong in the general election in certain states. But, you know, like you said, in our primary polls, we're pretty much right on. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I would say is this. Is this the end of polling? Is polling in trouble? As long as people want to know what's going on or guess what's going on, if the market is there, polling is going to continue to flourish. Now, are there challenges? Yes. Fewer people are answering phones, answering calls. It's tougher to get a hold of people. There are all sorts of high quality and low quality polls and, you know, different issues. But I think maybe the public might not want to hear this, but one thing that will help the public understand polling is to understand error. And you have to understand that the polls aren't going to be right all the time.
Well, how do you fix the issues of being able to contact voters?
It's difficult to do, just because it's our sampling frame, how we reach voters, isn't what it was in the 1950s and 60s, right? In the 1960s, that was the golden era, really, of polling, because everyone had a landline. It was easy to get a hold of them. Now we need to be more multimodal, and I would say this. News organizations should pay attention to polls that look at different methods. They should be looking at phone polls. They should be looking at online polls. Because if you're only looking at one sort of poll, then you could be introducing some sort of bias in your aggregation.
All right, we'll have to take a quick break. But when we return, we'll have final thoughts from our guests, plus what some of our viewers are saying about plans to redevelop the Quay property. So stay with us. Welcome back. After the 2016 election, it is time to rethink how much faith we put into the polls. Our guests join us now for final thoughts. Keith, I'll start with you because you've been involved with political campaigns. So What are these candidates going to do in terms of relying on them to give their you know, let them know what their path is and situational awareness?
Well, so big perspective. Remember, most down ballot campaigns don't rely a whole lot on polling.
Because they can't afford it.
You can maybe afford one or two polls over the course of a campaign. And they're still very, very reliable in helping you figure out how you shape your message, who you need to talk to, where you need to improve, where you don't. None of that has changed by any of this.
And Mitch,
yeah.
You cover the people who are involved in races and the general public, and they are very skewed at this point. So do you see, you know, the Democrats are still bleeding,
right.
The Republicans are proud. What's going to happen?
Well, I was just saying this about reporters, actually, because, you know, the pollsters have gotten beat up after this election, and so the media, right? Because people associate the media with somehow telling them that Trump was going to lose. I just think every reporter has to make sure that there's, as always, as responsible as possible on this stuff, because I'm not a prognosticator. I just try to literally report the facts. I think it's more than ever the media, because the spotlight is on us after this election, that we do that more thoroughly than ever.
Right. But you do refer to polls in practically every story.
Oh, I do. And I'm so sick of them, actually, that we have to do that, frankly.
And Frank, finally, is this a time of self-reflection in the polling industry?
I definitely think, you know, pollsters were kind of in mourning after that day. Pollsters, I think people need to realize, as long as they're not working for a campaign, they don't care who wins. They really just care, like, are we going to get this right? So the fact that they didn't get it right, we're all thinking, how can we do our job better? But we know that the public want us to keep, you know, getting more information out there.
And we're going to hold you to it. Mm-hmm. All right, gentlemen, thank you. Before we go, we want to share with you what some of you are saying about plans to redevelop the Quay property. On Monday, Sarasota City Commissioners gave approval for a $1 billion project for the site, which has sat vacant for a decade. Construction could begin as early as next year and is expected to take 10 years to complete. Here is what some of you are saying. Jacqueline Bevan writes, we can afford that, but we can't build a homeless shelter. Yeah, we have our priorities right in Sarasota. Don't we have enough condos? Colleen Giles writes, well, that's just perfect. More people, more traffic, more noise. And since we left the View build itself right in the road, there is no space to widen the road to handle the extra traffic in an area that floods already. And Tony Thomas writes, is there anything wrong with green space? You remember trees, grass, birds, picnics, fishing? If you'd like to join the conversation about tonight's topic, just visit our Facebook page at facebook.com/news@7. And FYI, want to watch past roundtable discussions? They're available on Apple TV, Amazon Fire, and Roku. Thank you to all our guests for being here tonight. Mitch Perry writes for floridapolitics.com. Frank Orlando is the director of St. Leo University's Polling Institute, and Keith Fitzgerald is a professor of political science at New College of Florida.